Thank you very much for the introduction. So, this is the summary of my talk. I'm going to speak a little bit about the issue of privacy versus utility, and then I will make a brief introduction to differential privacy and present the two main models that are used nowadays, the standard one, which is also called the central, and the local some approaches to local differential privacy. And in particular, I will focus on the local models. I hear an echo, it's a bit disturbing if someone else has the microphone on. So, I'll speak about the statistical utility and how to retrieve statistics from the local mechanisms. And finally, I'll present this the hybrid mechanisms that we are proposing, which is suitable for privacy in a distributed setting. So the issue of utility, it's one of the main issues in the field of privacy, because of course there is a tension between utility and privacy, in the sense that the more private you make your data, the more you obfuscate them and the less useful they are. And so the most of the research, one of the main research fields in the privacy community is try to come up with the mechanisms that allow a good privacy preservation and still have a good utility. So in general, we look for trying to get the optimal utility for a certain degree of privacy. Now, when we speak about utility, we should make a distinction between various kinds of utility. There is utility in the sense of quality of service, the sense of how much service you can get for the data you give. There is a utility in the sense of precision in the statistical analysis that you can make from the obfuscated data. And there is also accuracy in the sense of machine learning, and namely, if you use this data for training set for training an algorithm, training a model in machine learning, how accurate is the predictor that you obtain? And this thing, these kinds of utility are correlated with each other, in the sense that when you get so usually when you release your data is because you are interested in getting a certain service, and on the other end, the service provider is interested in collecting your data, and so there is both kind of utilities that enter the game. And the ideal would be, of course, to provide the mechanism that provides a good level of protection of the sensitive data, and at the same time optimizes both the quality of service and the precision of the statistics. Statistical precision and accuracy are quite related to each other, so I accumulate them in a unique class usually. Now, in this particular talk, I'm going to focus on the precision of statistics. And I'll explain a little bit now the model of differential privacy. So the differential privacy was proposed now about 15 years ago by Dworck, Cinzia Dworck and her colleagues, and has become extremely popular since then. And practically, I would say that is the most popular approach to privacy nowadays. The idea, you probably know already the definition of differential privacy, but let me remind it very quickly. The idea is that you have a mechanism for extracting, for answering query in a certain database, in a certain data set. And this mechanism usually provides also some obfuscation. So it's, say, a randomized mechanism. And we say that this mechanism provides differential privacy if whenever you have two adjacent databases, namely databases that differ only for one record, let's say X and X prime, for every possible answer Y that you can get from the mechanism applied to X prime, the probability to get to this Y is almost the same in the two databases. And when I say almost the same, I mean that their ratio is bounded by E to the power of epsilon, where epsilon is a parameter. And of course, the bigger epsilon is, the less privacy you have, because you can distinguish the two probability distribution more. So the idea is that since this ratio is bound, an attacker that has access only to the probability distribution of the answers will not be able to distinguish the presence or the absence of this record that makes the difference. And let me say that the reasons why differential privacy has become so popular are mainly two, and I would say that the first one, compositionality, is the most important. Compositionality means that if you combine the knowledge that you derive from mechanisms that have been protected by differential privacy, then you're guaranteed that what you obtain is still differentially private, although the degree of privacy decreases, but it decreases in a linear way and therefore is under control. This is a big difference with respect to the previous privacy notions that had been proposed. In particular, a very popular one was K-anonymity. So K-anonymity doesn't have this property at all. As soon as you put, it's possible, with the K-anonymity, it's possible to put together two, the knowledge from two different sources, both anonymized with the K-anonymity, and you lose anonymity entirely. So compositionality, of course, is a very important property. The other property that is often advertised for differential privacy is the fact that it is independent from side knowledge. Namely, if a mechanism is differential privacy with respect to a certain adversary with a certain knowledge about the rest of the world, you are guaranteed that it is differentially private with respect to any possible adversary, independently from the knowledge that he has. And this is very important, of course, because when you design a mechanism, you want to design in a way that it is universal, so valid in all possible circumstances. And of course, there are implementations for differential privacy, in particular, at least for pure differential privacy, which is the one I just explained, the two main mechanisms are Laplace and geometric, so addition of Laplace noise or addition of geometric noise. Now, this picture here represents the architecture of differential privacy, the kind that I just explained, namely the first notion that is nowadays called the central differential privacy. It's called the central because the idea is that you first collect the individual records And this assumes that you trust the collector of the data. This collector provides an interface with the external world, which is called the mechanism. And in the sense that the only way to access the database for any other agent is by submitting a query to the interface. And then the curator takes this query, computes the true answer on the database of the original data, and by the help of the mechanism, he adds some noise to this answer, and then this is what he reports to the agent that submitted the query. So the agent gets a noisy reply. And of course, from this noisy reply, you can try to derive a the statistical information that he wants. And I should make a distinction here between privacy security, because in security we usually separate the rightful agents, those of which we trust, and the agents that might be attackers. But this is not the case in privacy. In privacy, we assume that everybody is a potential attacker, except, of course, the data curator. Now, the problem with this architecture is, of course, that the data curator himself could be an attacker. And this is actually something that has happened in the past and still happening. I mean, Cambridge Analytica was an example of such a situation. And actually, it's not even necessary that the curator is corrupted. That could be that he simply is unable to secure the data. So there could be privacy breaches just because of security problems. So because of this problem, one notion that has become, people have come up with what is called the local model. And in particular, this model has become quite popular also because of the bigger companies like Google and Apple have been pushing for it. So in this model, the architecture is the one shown in this slide. The big difference is that the sanitization is not done after the collection of the data, but is done before the collection of the data. So it's done directly at the user side, individually, record by record, and they can even use a different mechanism for doing this sanitization. Then in this way, the data that are collected are already obfuscated, are already sanitized. So there is no risk of data. I mean, even if there is a data security breach, the attacker will only be able to collect obfuscated data. So this is much more secure than the central model. And of course, there are two issues about utility here, the same issues as before, namely how good the statistics can be on this noisy data. And the other issue is how good the quality of service is on the obfuscated record that the user gives to the service provider. But as I said before, I will just concentrate on statistical utility in this talk. So to explain the local differential privacy, the local differential privacy is very similar as a mathematical formula to the property of standard differential privacy. The only difference is that instead of databases here, X and X prime are single records. So here in this formula, essentially X and X prime represent different values that this record can have. And the property is the same as before, namely the probability to get the same answer y from the mechanism applied to x or to x prime is almost the same. Namely, the ratio is bound by the power of epsilon. And to explain a bit how this works, let's make an example. So there is a very famous mechanism called the randomized response, which actually was invented many decades ago. The idea is that we want to collect, we want to make a pool to find out what is the answer to some question. And let's assume that this is an embarrassing question and people are not going to answer. It's not likely that people will answer truthfully if we ask the question directly. So suppose, for instance, that we want to make an investigation on what's the percentage of people that cheat on their spouses. So if you ask this question directly, it's not likely that people will say, yes, I do cheat on my spouse. So what you do instead is to ask people to execute the following protocol. Namely, they throw a coin, and if the coin is, say, head, then they answer the truth. Otherwise, they throw the coin again and they answer whatever the coin says. So say yes if the coin is head and no if the coin is tail. So in this way, even if a person answers yes, you cannot, is protected in the sense that you cannot be sure that this person really cheats on his spouse. And so it's more likely that that you will answer the truth. I mean, you will be more motivated, that's why, to execute the protocol and answer the truth when he has to answer the truth. If you look at the relation, the probabilistic relation between the real answer, the true answer, and the reported answer, you get what we call a stochastic matrix associated to the mechanism, which is this matrix with the rows, yes and no, and columns. The rows are the true answer, what would be the true answer, yes and no, and the columns are what is the reported answer. So, for instance, if the true answer is yes, you will report a yes with the probability 3/4. Because this is the probability that you get either a head at the first attempt, or if you get a tail, you get then head again. So 1/2 plus 1/4, which is 3/4. And the same for no, and vice versa. If the true answer is yes, you will report no with the probability 1/4. So this mechanism is actually has become very popular, and is actually the basic mechanism on which the proposal of Google, for instance, is based. It's called the rapport. It's a bit more sophisticated, but the core of the mechanism is this one. Except, of course, that the binary case is a bit limited, so it has been extended to the general K case, where K is the domain of the all possible values. So when you have a K-ary domain instead of binary, then the mechanism is a bit different. So it's illustrated here. Essentially, what you do, you give the true answer with the probability C times E at the power of epsilon, and every other answer with the probability C, where C is a constant that is essentially there in order to make this probability distribution. So it's a normalization factor. And we also call it a flat mechanism in the sense that apart from the true answer, it is flat, namely uniform on all the rest of the domain. So the nice thing about this notion, local differential privacy, is that it is compositional and independent from the side knowledge in the same way. So it has the same properties as the standard differential privacy. Now, let me present another approach to local differential privacy that has been developed by myself and other people in my team. The notion is described by this equation here in red. And it's very similar to local differential privacy, except that now the bound on the ratio of the two probabilities is not just e to the power of epsilon, but we put in the exponent also the distance between the true answers, x and x prime. So this, of course, is a reasonable notion only if we have a domain where we can give a meaningful notion of distance. But it's quite often the case, because, and in particular, we can always cover the case of local of stand or the previous notion of local differential privacy by taking for the discrete distance, namely the distance that gives zero if x is equal to x prime, and gives one in all the other cases. And it also generalizes the notion of standard differential privacy if we assume that x and x prime are databases and d is the Hamming distance between two databases. And again, this notion is has the same properties, nice properties as standard differential privacy, namely is is compositional, is independent from the side knowledge, and as the property, like, it's local, is a local mechanism in the sense that can be applied at the user side. It doesn't need the data are collected. And also this notion has been implemented. There are various mechanisms that satisfy this notion. For instance, the extended Laplace and the extended geometric, extended in the sense that instead of being in a linear domain, they are in a vector space. For instance, we have used this notion a lot for location privacy, where the data are location data, and assume for simplicity that they are points on a plane. So the typical, in this case, the typical mechanism would be the planar Laplace, which is this shape shown in this graph. And it's also efficient because if we do it with the polar coordinates, it's very easy to generate to draw elements from this samples from this distribution. Now, what about the statistical utility? So the main issue when we speak about the local differential privacy is how to retrieve the original distribution, namely the distribution from which the true data are sampled. From this, if we are able to estimate the original distribution, then we can do all other statistics typically. Now, the estimation mechanism that is defined, so let me introduce some terminology first of all. So this is the privacy mechanism, local in the sense that we sanitize each record independently. Let me call pi the original distribution from which these data are sampled, the true data, the original data. And let me call q the empirical distribution that we get by counting the frequencies of the noisy death, I mean, the after sanitization. It will actually be useful to look at the stochastic matrix associated to the mechanism. So we have a sequence of random variables x1, x2, x3 that represent the data and are drawn from pi, and the y1, y2, y3 that are random variables obtained by adding by applying the conditional probabilities of the stochastic matrix to the inputs x1, x2, x3, etc. Now, from this empirical distribution, knowing the mechanism, so in general we know what we know is the mechanism, so the stochastic matrix and the empirical distribution. The purpose of the analysis is try to estimate pi. Pi is the thing that we don't know and we want to estimate. So the estimation mechanism in general will produce a probability distribution P, and of course the point is how close, how good P approximates, how well P approximates pi. Now, let me make an example. Okay, so first of all, there are basically two methods that have been proposed in the literature. The first one is the matrix inversion method, and is very simple. So assuming that C is the stochastic matrix associated to the mechanism and Q is the empirical distribution, the estimation mechanism is simply the one that applies the inverse OC, or the stochastic matrix, to the empirical distribution. And essentially, it amounts to solve a system of linear equations. So let me make an example. Going back to this random response mechanism in the binary case, you remember we had this matrix 3/4, 1/4, etc. So we simply write the system of equation that amounts to multiply the probability distribution on X, which is a vector of unknown variables, by the matrix, and then we get the empirical Y, and Y is known. And then we solve the system of equations simply. And for instance, if the empirical answer yes was 60% and no was 40%, we would solve this system of equation and get that the true, the estimation of the true probability of yes is 70% and of no is 30%. Now, there are two problems with this method. One is that, first of all, C must be invertible, otherwise the method is simply inapplicable. And the second problem is that when we solve the system of equations, we could be the case that we don't get a distribution. I mean, we get a vector, but not representative of a real distribution, because it could contain negative elements or elements that are greater than one. So for instance, this could happen in this example if the empirical distribution on yes is 80% and on no 20%, we solve the system and we find out that the original distribution would be 110% for yes and minus 10% for no, which of course is not a probability distribution. Now, this happens simply because when we have done, when we add the noise, it's again a random outcome. So it might be quite unlucky and given yes many more times than we should have given. And that's why it doesn't correspond anymore to something realistic. Now, what do we do when we are in a situation like this? Well, essentially, there are two possibilities, two methods that have been proposed. One is we just set to zero all the negative elements and then renormalize. Or the other possibility is to project the vector that we have got on the simplex, namely find the closest vector on the simplex, to the closest to the vector we have found. And both of these methods, especially the second one, gives good results when this estimation mechanism is paired with the KRR privacy mechanism. But this is the only case that we have found, because for instance, if we, for deep privacy, this approach does not give good results at all. So for deep privacy, we have proposed another approach, another estimation mechanism that is based on the so-called iterative Bayesian update. And essentially is comes from a very well-known method in statistics that is called the maximization expectation, that is a way to estimate an unknown variable. And the nice thing about this mechanism is that it produces a maximum likelihood estimator of the true distribution. Namely, given the mechanism C and given the empirical distribution on the noisy data Q, this IBU, iterative Bayesian update, produces the distribution P that is one of the most likely that if we give an input to C, produces Q. Now, I said one of the most likely because in general there could be, is not unique, the maximum likelihood estimator. And if it's not unique, then it's a problem. I mean, this method is always applicable, but if the maximum likelihood estimator is not unique, then we can never be guaranteed to get the real distribution, because of course, if it's not unique, there are infinitely many. So it's practically impossible to get exactly the true distribution. However, if C is invertible, then we are guaranteed that this maximum likelihood estimator is unique. And furthermore, the IBU converges to the real distribution. So when I say converge, I mean that the more data we have, the more input, the more samples from the distribution we have, the more this approximation becomes precise, which is rather intuitive because of the law of the large numbers. The way it works, so first of all, it always works even when C is not unique, is not invertible. It always converges to something, even if C is not invertible. And the way it works is the following. We have to start, so it's iterative, right? So which means that we construct a series of probability distributions that converge towards this fixed point P. And we have to start with the fully supported distribution, for instance, the uniform distribution, and then at each step to obtain the next distribution, we apply this formula described in red here, which looks a lot like the Bayesian law, the Bayes theorem, except that we have to instead of having one observable, we have several observables. So what we do, essentially, we take the average of the expectation on all these observables, where the expectation is computed with respect to the empirical distribution Q. So in this way, yeah, we obtain a series of distributions that converges in the sense that in general what happens, and this happens even if a C is not invertible, that it happens that the difference between the next step and the previous one becomes smaller and smaller. So when it is small enough, we can stop because we are closer to the fixed point. Now, how do these two methods compare? Well, first of all, it's not so easy. The two mechanisms of KRR and deprivacy. Well, by mechanism and deprivacy, I mean the Laplace or the geometric. How do they compare? Well, in terms of trade-off between privacy and utility. So first of all, we have, in order to compare their privacy, we need to tune the epsilon, because they both depend on epsilon, on a parameter epsilon, but is not this epsilon doesn't have the same meaning in the two definitions. So we have to tune these two parameters so that they reflect the same notion of privacy. And we can do that by deciding what is the area of interest in which we want to have the same level of privacy. And then we tune them so to provide the same privacy in this area. Now, once we do that, we can say, okay, we have found the same level of privacy. We have found the two corresponding mechanisms in the two classes. And now we can compute their utility. And so the utility, again, is statistical utility. So we want to estimate the original distribution. So here is an experiment with the geographical data. So this is a Govalla data set, which is a data set containing the check-in in various cities in the world. We have chosen San Francisco here. So check-in is essentially a point in the map where the user has been at a certain moment. By the way, how much time do I have still?
Let's say 15 minutes.
Okay, and then I have to accelerate. Okay, so this is the original distribution, what you see projected here. So after we apply the Laplace, say we get a much more flattened out distribution, obviously so, because there is a noise added and that spreads the distribution out. And now what I'm going to show is how the estimation mechanism works. So this is an animated GIF that in every photogram shows then one distribution in this iterative process. So as you can see, it's trying to reconstruct the original distribution, which is the one on the left. And it's not completely the same, but it's pretty precise. The next one is what we get when we apply the KRR. So first of all, we can observe that it's much more spread out, and that's sort of intuitive because it's a flat mechanism, so that spreads the distribution, the probability mass uniformly on all data. So obviously we get on all data that are not the true one. So obviously we get something much more spread out. And also when we try to reconstruct the original one, the result is much less precise. We need many more data with the KRR to achieve good results. In general, the Laplace mechanism is much more useful for the same. Here are some evaluation of this precision expressed in terms of the Kantorovich distance between, the Kantorovich distance is also known as Earth Movers distance, between the original distribution and the estimated one. So the yellow box plot indicates what we get with the KRR, and the other two box plots on the which are very close to the bottom represent the planar Laplace and the planar geometric. And as you can see, they give a much more precision, about 7 times more precise than the KRR. And we did the same experiment also in Paris, and we got similar result. So finally, the last part of my talk is about the privacy mechanism for the distributed setting. So what I mean by that distributed setting is simply that the databases are not collected in a unique place, but they are distributed across various organizations. Now, typically, this is a rather important problem nowadays, because it's quite typical that different institutes or companies have their own data. They don't want to share this data with other companies, but they want to get together their knowledge somehow, combine the information that they can get from this database, because this, of course, gives better statistics. The more data you have, the better statistics you can obtain in general. Now, the problem is that, of course, they want to be private. I mean, they want to do it privately. They don't want to share the data with each other. So how can we do that? So there are various proposals, and our proposal is is very simple to explain. So essentially, what we do is very simple, is we apply a local differential privacy mechanism to each record individually within a database in a certain company, okay? And then for the estimation, we simply apply the typical estimation mechanism for local differential privacy, either the matrix inversion or the iterative Bayesian update. Now, what's the difference with the local model? What's the advantage? I mean, so far looks completely the same, but it's not the same because the notion of adversary in this case is not the one of the local model, but is the one of the central model, which is a much weaker notion, a much weaker adversary. And because of that, the trade-off between privacy and utility is much better than in the local model. And the attack, to explain better what I mean, the attacker in the local model is assumed to be able to see the obfuscated version of each record individually. In the central model, the attacker can only see the aggregated result of the obfuscation. So it has much less information. And each individual datum is protected not only by the local obfuscation mechanism, but also by the aggregation. So the privacy is much, much higher than in the local model. And concerning utility essentially works like this, right? We call like in the local model, we collect the noisy data, we form an histogram, we normalize, so to obtain a distribution, and then we apply the estimation mechanism. So it's exactly the same as in the local model. And to compare with the central model, in the central model, if we wanted to do the same thing, namely to estimate the original distribution, what we would do is first we make the histogram of the original data, Then we apply noise to each bin independently. And then what we get is the histogram that we get normalized to a distribution is what we give, we make public. Now, what we have found out experimentally is that these two results are pretty much the same. So the central model and the local model give almost the same precision of the estimation of the original distribution, which is very good news in a sense. On the other hand, why do we propose this hybrid mechanism? Why don't we adopt the central model then? Well, the big difference is that our hybrid mechanism is compositional, and at least when we use the iterative Bayesian update or the matrix inversion applied to KRR. And but what I mean by this is that this situation here, where we first compute the local, when we first apply the local noise, the local differential private noise to each database of the various institutions, and from the resulting noise histogram, we compute, we combine with the EBOD, with one of the two mechanisms that I have explained before. So we get an estimation of the original distribution, which is completely equivalent to what we would get if the databases were all in the same location and we applied this mechanism to all of them at the same time. So it's not just similar, it's really the same. So assuming that each sanitization of each individual record is done, happens to be the same in the two situations, then the estimation that we get is exactly the same. So this is a very strong result, I would say. And it does not hold for the standard differential privacy. Essentially, okay, so we can of course try to do the same thing, namely combine the histograms that we get when we apply standard differential privacy, but what we get is much less accurate, is much less precise than what we would have if the all data were combined in the same location. I mean, if they were all in a unique database. In the sense that in this distributed case, the variance is much larger. So one last thing, between these two mechanisms, so the privacy and IBU and on one side and KRR and matrix inversion on the other side, which one is better to choose? Well, if you are interested in precision, then, okay, sorry. If you're interested in efficiency, then KRR plus matrix inversion is much more efficient. By the way, matrix inversion in the case of KRR is very easy to solve. You don't have to find the inverse of the matrix. There is a formula that gives with the complex linear complexity, give you the result. However, the privacy and IBU are much more precise. So first of all, IBU is much more general because it can be applied to any privacy mechanism, not just the KRR, and not just the privacy. It can be applied to any mechanism that is, and if it is invertible, it gives also the guarantee that it approximates the original distribution. And furthermore, if you use the privacy in combination with IBU, that's a much better estimation accuracy, as you have seen in the example of the Govalla, in the experiment with the Govalla. Right, so conclusion. So we have proposed an hybrid approach for differential privacy in a distributed setting, which is better than local differential privacy concerning the trade-off between privacy and utility, and is better compositionality properties than the standard differential privacy. In the future work, we want to explore other mechanisms, in particular the Gaussian, because it's something that is very, well, there are various reasons why it's popular. And more important, we want to explore how this work, what kind of trade-off our mechanism can give when it is used in a machine learning context. I mean, trade-off with the accuracy of the model that you get from learning in a database, on a training data set that has been obfuscated with our mechanism. We think that, there has been a lot of research done in learning in a privately friendly way. And there are controversial results in the sense that on one hand, privacy, differential privacy helps to avoid the problem of overfitting. So models that have been trained with the database sanitized with differential privacy are more generalized better. But on the other hand, depending on the kind of data, you can lose precision. We think that if we use the privacy instead of differential privacy, things can go much better. The trade-off with the accuracy can be much better. And this concludes my talk. So thank you very much, and I'll take your questions.
Thank you very much, Katusha. Are there any questions for our invited speaker?
Thanks. I have a few questions. Thanks, Katusha, for this talk. It was very clear. First, a very naive question at the beginning when you describe this this way to obfuscate the data in some sense for this annoying question about cheating. So you said that so we don't have the exactly this stochastic matrix. So we don't have the exact answer of the people we ask, but we still have a kind of idea of his exact answer, right? Because we can see that this 3-4 indicates that there is some high probability on what was his real answer. But yeah, still, yeah. We admit that this is enough regarding privacy, right?
Yeah. So it's not an absolute privacy. It's approximate privacy, if you want. Yeah. But you can tune your parameters. So if you are not happy with the 3/4 likelihood to get the same answer, then you can say that you get ahead in the first time you throw the coin. Instead of throwing a fair coin, you throw a coin that is very biased towards tail. So you tell the truth very rarely. But of course, that makes you lose precision.
And so later in your talk, you say that if we are not lucky, we can get, when we try to invert the matrix, we can get negative values, which is bad. And so I had the intuition that in some sense, it's related to the way we have chosen these probabilities in this coin tossing.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So the more flat, noise you add, the more likely you get something that makes no sense. Yes. In the sense that is out of the simplex.
So in some sense, the two are completely in the opposite directions. If you...
Yeah, absolutely. So you can see very well the trade-off here between privacy and utility. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. And so another question I had is about this this C matrix. So in the case of a matrix inversion, so okay, we in some sense we have to choose the stochastic matrix to for this trade-off. So we can ensure the first property of being invertible. So it's rather easy. But so for this second property, is it something? So the second problem was about this. Yes, we obtained something which is not a probability distribution, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
So this is something.
There is nothing you can do about that. I mean, the more noise you add, the more likely is that you get something that is negative. Yeah.
So if we want to avoid the second problem, in some sense, we will have to remove the noise. So it's not, there is no real solution.
No. The IBU, however, gives a better result in general. So this one always gives a distribution. It doesn't go outside of the simplex. It always remains inside the simplex. However, also in this case, of course, the problem here is that you always converge to a maximum likelihood estimator, but the more noise you have, the more likely is, the more likely is that the maximum likelihood estimator for the empirical distribution that you get in output can be very different from the real distribution, because it's the best estimator for the empirical noisy distribution, but the empirical noisy distribution can be very far from the ideal output distribution. If you see what I mean?
It will take more time to converge.
Not only that, it can be really different from pi. So you get the P that you get is guaranteed to be the maximum likelihood, the probability that is maximum likelihood to give the Q that you have found in output. But that Q can be very different from the ideal distribution that you would obtain if the matrix was multiplied by pi. You see what I mean?
Yes.
Just because of the noise there are two sources of randomness. So one is pi and the other is the matrix itself. So what you get in output can be very much influenced by the matrix.
So about this IBU, I was wondering, so you say that it's converging and you show some experiments. So do you have any estimation of the speed of convergence or?
It also depends on the noise. The less noise you have, the faster it converges. I don't have I had some experiments about that, but I didn't put it in the slides. I can send them to you if you want to have them.
No, I was wondering if you had some theoretical results on this.
Speed. It's related to the noise. We haven't not studied that.
Okay. And so maybe I had a last question about this, the last part on a hybrid model, because if I understood correctly, so in the central model, one of the issue was that the collector may be corrupted.
Yeah.
But so is it also a possible issue in this hybrid model, meaning that...
So in the hybrid model, depends on how you collect. So in principle, you could, it's not necessary that you first collect the data and then you apply the mechanism. You can collect the data already sanitized. However, at that point, you have two notions of adversary. One that is the collector himself, and that is a bad adversary, as bad as in the local model. And the other is the other companies that don't see they see the result after the collection has been done. and they are much weaker adversary because, as I said before, in that case, each individual datum is obfuscated not only by the mechanism, but also by the aggregation.
Yes, I see. Okay, but so we could imagine.
Yeah, you could imagine that the collection is done on data that are already sanitized at the yes. user side. That, yeah, maybe is the best possible scenario. Mm.
Okay, thanks.
Any other question or remarks?
Another question?
Go ahead.
Thank you again for the talk. My question is there anything to gain to, because here when we ask question to a user, we store one answer, which can later be obfuscated, but is there anything to gain to store a distribution of answers in terms of privacy or utility for one user, for one answer of one user?
Oh, distribution. Ah, yeah, you can do that, sure. The model does not change. It's just you can just imagine that there are two instances of the same random variable, of the equally identically distributed random variable. Yeah. IDD. I think from the point of view of the utility, nothing changes. So from the point of view of the privacy, I would say that if every user gives the same number of answers, then nothing changes. Just like if you replicate the database 10 times with different sampling. Sorry, n times with different sampling. If the contribution of each user can be out of proportion with respect to the others, say one user is gives 100 answers and the others. No, maybe not, because they are anyway sampled always from the same distribution. So maybe that nothing changes. But okay. I haven't thought. It's a very interesting question, but I have not thought about the influence on privacy. Certainly on utility, I would say that there's not nothing changes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, probably one, two, or more questions if they are. So there are any other question for Katushin?
So maybe I have a question. So thank you again, Katusha, for the excellent talk. So I have a question with regard to the robustness, maybe. So so it's a continuation of the question of Pierre-Alain, maybe. So imagine that in our hybrid system, one of the actor that is supposed to obfuscate the data, so one of the obfuscator is flawed. And so maybe it does not obfuscate really the data. So is it then possible that when you aggregate the different data,
very interesting.
Then you recover some information of the flawed, not the flawed actor, but the other ones?
No, I think not, because of this independence of, So you leak the true information, no, but is when in differential privacy you make the hypothesis that the adversary has the maximum knowledge, can have the maximum knowledge possible. So if the data are not correlated, they have no influence. I mean, if these are really drawn in an independent way, then there is no risk for the privacy of the other institutions. The risk would be, of course, if there is some correlation. I mean, if you know that, for instance, the same person is in database A and database B, then of course.
so the actor that is flawed cannot learn any new information that is not correlated to his one by not obfuscating his own data.
No.
That was my question.
Unless you know about the correlation, then
okay.
Absolutely not, because it's just like any other attacker. I mean, so.
Okay, thank you.
But it's a very good question. I didn't think about that yet.
Is there one last question? Okay, so let's thank again Katyusha. Imagine that we are applauding you.
thank you. It was a pleasure.
The invitation. And okay, so clap. Yes. There is one. Okay, thank you very much for everyone, and let's update our seminars for the new year in January. So thank you very much, Katyusha. Thank you very much for
thanks for the invitation, and have a nice Christmas then.
See you.